Hello everyone, I'm Nathan Rich, also known as Hu Guo Da Wang. In the last episode, China saw the coming of a great evil, violent expansionism fueled by a budding system of markets, a proto-capitalism called merchant capitalism. Global expansionist policies contributed markedly to the Industrial Revolution, a productivity and prosperity boost for several Western countries. Some of these countries enforced inequality on a global scale. The Great Evil had, in a matter of decades, already consumed the lives of millions of Indians, other Asians, Africans, and savage races. Many were lost in wars meant to enforce free trade, or in artificial famines created or exacerbated by economic oppression and extreme exploitation. The Qing Empire, however, was mostly unaffected by violence outside its borders. The British Empire had invaded Nepal, a protectorate of China, but hadn't pushed into China proper. The Great Evil was making its way to the shores of China, however, in the form of opium traders backed by tea-addicted England. Over 7,000 kilograms of opium were illegally smuggled into China per day, more than 15,000 pounds. But the Qing finally put a complete stop to the cartels in a coordinated crackdown. All that was left to do was reason with Britain, the Lion. Stop your lethal violations of our laws. Trade only legal goods. But the Qing's sense of security, hubris, dignity, and sovereignty would all soon meet that great evil head-on. This episode will cover less than a single year. 1839 was the last year in history that China proper was totally free of official foreign interventionism. It spent that last fateful year trying to reason with the Lion. Welcome back to Epic China. Machines, steam, technology, religion, tea, expansion, more dead Indians, opium, profit. In some ways, these were the buzzwords of the British Empire in 1839. The Industrial Revolution, brought on in part from rising one-sided trade, made military and industrial progress boom in the West. In China, the fight against opium continued. An edict against opium was issued in January of 1839. Lin Zexu, who had recently been appointed in charge of ending the opium smuggling, had clear instructions from the Daoguang Emperor. Yesterday, we received a decree, particularly entrusting the Governor General, Lin Zexu, with the mission of hurrying to Guangdong Province to investigate and manage maritime affairs. He must reverently obey our order to exert all his strength to resolve this matter by clearing up the source of this fraud. It also means that he must, according to the place and circumstances, radically sever the trunk from the roots. Even before he arrived, warnings came down to traders, foreign or otherwise. The overly confident Qing officials' attitudes are clearly discernible from the warning's contents. Finally, it appears that at this present moment, the great emperor is now dispatching an imperial commissioner to Guangzhou. He's now not far off. His arrival may be expected every hour. He intends to cut off the fountain of abuse, to do away utterly with this great evil. He is determined to sink his ships and break his cauldrons, nor will he stay his hand till all be pure in his sight. The dullness and stupidity, then, of ye foreigners, indeed calls forth our deepest grief and indignation. but still cherishing a feeling of compassion for the men from afar, we could not rest patiently without giving this most tender and earnest warning to you extra. Foreigners were unsure how long the arrests would last. By this time, there had been so many instances of corruption, few foreigners believed it would be long. They still hoped for opium to be legalized, allowing them to offload more smoking death for profit. Long, official anti-opium placards began popping up all over Guangzhou. A Chinese opium smuggler was strangled to death in front of the foreign trade buildings. The second in 3 months, arrests were widespread. It was beginning to look as if the crackdown was going to be real this time. Upon arrival in March, Lin Zexu began carrying out the emperor's instructions vigorously. Another edict against opium was published. Lin demanded Western traders surrender their illegal drugs within 3 days. He offered them free pardons should they comply. By this time, there were up to 25 opium hulk ships off the shore of Guangzhou, with enormous volumes of opium ready to smuggle. Much of it had been brought on rumors of opium legalization that never came to pass. The foreigners, after some time, offered Lin 60,000 kilograms of pure opium,
130,000 pounds.
But this wasn't even close to their full stockpiles, so he did not accept. Opium trade had already been completely halted since November. In response to their insulting offer, he halted all foreign trade, legal or not. This opium issue needed to be resolved first. China was closed for business. The mighty Qing finally put its foot down on the foreigners. 350 of them were blockaded in the factory's area. No one was leaving until the illegal narcotics were turned over. Foreigners on lockdown came together to challenge the Chinese government, who had rather unfairly wanted them to follow Chinese laws while they were in China. The various countrymen rallied each other in the name of Jesus. I exhort you all as Christian men that it is your duty in this peculiar country to consider yourselves as the subjects of one nation, as your different interests as opposed to the tyrannical domination of this government are one. It was the first clear instance of Western powers banding together to fight the tyranny of Chinese law. But foreign opinions were unimportant to the celestial empire of China. The Daoguang was going to once and for all get China the respect it deserved. Lin wanted foreign traders to sign bonds, contracts, that they would not trade in opium further or be subject to Chinese punishment, including execution. Though the East India Company had already done this 20 years prior, this time it was resisted by nearly all the traders. Most claimed innocence in the smuggling trade, but were unwilling to sign promissory notes, which would have subjected them to Chinese laws voluntarily. Ultimately, though, the merchant rebellion was short-lived. The Western empires and states couldn't negotiate their way out of this one. They surrendered a large portion of their stockpiles, possibly all of it. These early capitalists forfeited nearly 1.3 million kilograms of opium, or 2.8 million pounds, enough to kill many millions of people. Lin wrote a letter to the British Queen, Victoria. There is a tribe of depraved and barbarous people who, having manufactured opium for smoking, bring it hither for sale and seduce and lead astray the simple folk to the destruction of their persons and the draining of their resources. Formerly, the smokers thereof were few, but of late, the practice has spread its contagion, and daily do its baneful effects more deeply pervade the central source, its rich, fruitful, and flourishing population. Hence it is that those who deal in opium or who inhale its fume within this land are all now to be subjected to severest punishment, and not having as yet sent any communication to your honorable sovereignty, should severest measures of interdiction be all at once enforced, it might be said in excuse that no previous knowledge thereof had been possessed. We would have your honorable nation issue mandates for the collection thereof, that the whole may be cast into the depths of the sea. It was an honest appeal to the government of Britain to end its drug empire. Most of the letter may have seemed innocent and naive to the Brits, but there was something much more urgent and dangerous that needed attention. A direct threat to fair trade was exposed. It will be discovered, after all, that no place will afford opportunity for selling it, that no profits will be attainable. If any be again introduced into foreign vessels, it too must be subjected to a process of destruction. Other commodities imported in such vessels should meet a common fate. the gem and the pebble not being distinguished. Any ships coming to sell opium would be burned to the sea with no account for profit loss. That was serious. Any other items on the ships would also burn and drown in the ocean, the gem and the pebble not being distinguished. This was the end of the opium trade as far as Lin Zexu was concerned, the final warning. By May, the opium was fully handed over and a decision was made not to bring it to Beijing for inspection by the emperor. Instead, enormous pits were dug for the product to be dissolved and chemically burned before being let out to sea. The process took 500 people nearly a month straight to achieve. One worker tried to take some in the process. He was killed on the spot. In terms of weight, it was the largest drug bust in human history by an order of magnitude. Nothing before or since has ever been even close. Lin wrote a second letter to the British Queen Victoria, further pleading on the basis of morality for Britain to discontinue its illegal drug smuggling. His letter is a fascinating glimpse into the mindset of a do-gooder official of the day, proud of his alleged high-level understanding of foreign ways. He began by suggesting Britain's success was owed to China. "We of the heavenly dynasty nourished and cherished your people from afar, and bestowed upon them redoubled proofs of our urbanity and kindness. It is merely from these circumstances that your country, deriving immense advantage from its commercial intercourse with us, has become the rich and flourishing kingdom that it is said to be." There is an element of truth to that statement, but it casts doubt on his understanding of the Western mindset. He then went on at great length, trying to reason the Queen into abandoning the opium market. "Your foreign ships come hither, striving the one with the other for our trade, and for the simple reason of their strong desire to reap a profit. The immense wealth which the said foreigners amass ought, properly speaking, to be proportion of our own native Chinese people. By what principle of reason, then, should these foreigners send in return a poisonous drug which involves in destruction those very natives of China? From their inordinate thirst after gain, they are perfectly careless about the injuries they inflict upon us. We should like to ask what has become of that conscience which heaven has implanted in the breasts of all men. If we of the central land were to grudge you what is beneficial and not to compassionate your wants, then wherewithal could you foreigners manage to exist? The things that come from your foreign countries are only calculated to make presents of, or serve for mere amusement. It is quite the same to us if we have them, or if we have them not." Month by month and year by year, the volume of the poison increases. Its unclean stench ascends upwards until heaven itself grows angry, and the very gods thereat get indignant. And then he wrote, "Our celestial empire rules over 10,000 kingdoms. Most surely do we possess a measure of godlike majesty, which ye cannot fathom. Let then your highness punish those of your subjects who may be criminal. Do not endeavor to screen or conceal them. Thus will you more than ever display a proper sense of respect and obedience." No reply was ever given, and no one is sure if the queen ever received the message. It was, however, printed in foreign newspapers after some time. The message was quite abrasive to whoever had read it, surely. But perhaps the most naive assertion from any culture in history was when the Qing government made this revealing threat to the foreign drug smugglers, urging them further to turn in their drugs to prevent trade being shut down. "We find that the respective kings of all these different countries have been hitherto obedient and submissive, and further, that the laws which govern you foreigners are rigorous in the extreme. It is to be presumed that when your supplies of tea and rhubarb are cut off, an inquiry will take place as to the way in which this has been brought about. And thus, O ye foreigners, though ye may escape the net of our laws, yet ye may find it difficult to escape the net of your own." The Qing officials thought that the Western countries were going to hold their merchants to obey laws. The Qing had not yet had the chance to see how wrong their disposition was. For a brief moment, they were allowed to continue living in their dream, one in which Britain and the United States would value rule of law over profit, or at least try to maintain relative harmony, as the Portuguese had. It was a wonderful dream, but it didn't last long. A proclamation to the foreigners clarified the government's justification and pride in its success. "The evil has gradually spread over the whole coast and infected every province of the empire. There are those who say that your object is to drain China of its wealth and deprive its subjects of their lives. Opinions of this kind, however, we, out of compassion, will not stop to discuss. The territory of the Central Land produces the five precious metals in rich profusion. Its treasuries and stores are heaped up and running over. How could ye, by your petty arts, exhaust us? Traders who once lived in Guangzhou had mostly all moved to nearby Macau, which was legally operated by Portugal with strict laws. There they awaited instructions from their governments. In those days, simply sending and receiving a message would take around 6 months' time. In July, several British shipmen got drunk and ransacked a mainland village, beating several Chinese farmers in the process and killing one. They retreated to their ships, unwilling to reveal which of them had actually killed the farmer. Qing soldiers, possibly looking for revenge, boarded a small British ship and killed five sailors, leaving a sixth with his own ears in his mouth. The Qing government demanded the murderer be turned over. If the foreigners refused to give up the murderer himself, then any one of them would do in his place. This was common practice for cases like this. Charles Elliot of the British East India Company offered five black barbarians instead. One white British execution, traded for the killing of a Chinese man, was an affront to the British sense of individualism and righteousness. But five black executions was not an affront, it seemed. Lin rejected Elliot's offer and cut off all food and fuel sales to Macau, as he was required to do by Qing law. Cutting off trade during times in which a foreigner was wanted for murder had also happened before. This is how things were done. The British had never fully submitted to Chinese laws, even while living, working, and trading in China. Chinese courts and law enforcement methods were harsh, especially to murderers. These issues were not unknown in British discourse. There were some peaceful, rational voices in Britain. It being granted that in Europe every government has a right to administer its own laws to its own subjects, and also to those foreigners who seek its territory, who are, during the time of their residence, both amenable to and protected by the laws. It may seem a strange interference with this indisputable national right to question it in the case of China. In cases of homicides by foreigners elsewhere, the homicide is tried by the laws and punished by the laws, and why should not this law of nations be submitted to in China? The laws of China didn't suit the foreigners, nor did they treat foreigners as Chinese were treated. Teaching the Chinese language was at times illegal, as was spreading Christianity. Instead of packing up and moving on to the next country to trade, however, the foreigners continued to push for trade in China. They made the bold choice to trade in an imbalanced legal situation. It was a choice they continued to make year after year, decade after decade, for hundreds of years. Then, instead of accepting the conditions of trade with China or peacefully moving on, they chose to change Chinese laws. Already in British discussions was the question of how to deal with those unfavorable conditions in China. Setting aside the method of mere force, it is not easy to discover a credible way by which any European government can approach that of China. Embassies are considered as acknowledgments of fealty, and presents are received as tribute. According to Chinese arrogance, those nations which have sent embassies to China have bowed to her supremacy, and according to Chinese reasoning, an attempt by those nations to interfere with or alter the laws and regulations of China, as they regard foreigners and foreign commerce, would be, in their own words, plotting great rebellion. The profession of the Chinese government to hold dominion over those nations which have sent ambassadors and presents must appear ridiculous, but it is by no means ridiculous, particularly in the 19th century, that it should be allowed to plead its right to continue its own laws in its own territories. Dissenting pacifist voices existed, but were becoming more rare. Tension was rising between the growingly impatient British and the eternally patient Qing. September 1839, the British traders sailed up to Kowloon, demanding food from Chinese vessels there, though they had not run out. Because trade had been shut down, there was no reply. And that lack of response, in their minds, justified them opening fire. It was one of Britain's first direct attempts at forcing trade from China. It wouldn't be the last. The Chinese reported they had succeeded in sinking four British ships during the skirmish. In reality, they hadn't sunken any. It was common in China for local governments to misrepresent facts to the larger government to save face and avoid demotions or worse. The British tried to get Americans to leave the trade area with them in protest of the opium bonds, but the Americans stayed. They signed the contracts promising not to trade in opium, which gave them exclusive access to legal trade with the Qing. Soon thereafter, British traders began capitulating too. Fear of losing the market's edge drove them to accept the bonds. But Elliot sent warships to stop British subjects from signing or trading. He didn't want any more British to trade with China while these opium bonds were required. After all, why should superior British subjects be held responsible for crimes committed in the inferior, savage China? It didn't make any sense. Britain was flexing its might in nearby India, Nepal. The Qing, meanwhile, paid little attention. A British ship, which had the legal right to trade, was escorted by Chinese ships to do so. Elliot sent warships to stop that trade and began firing on his fellow countrymen. Chinese ships moved in to protect the ship's legal, sanctioned trade. Surely they wouldn't continue to fire on a legal trade. But China wasn't trading how Britain wanted it to. It wasn't accepting Christianity. It didn't believe in the same free trade that Britain did. It might only take one further misunderstanding to escalate tensions to a new level. The antisocial, impracticable government of China will always array great difficulties against foreign commerce. And until China herself descends from her high pretensions and opens the ways of freer communication, there is not much to encourage hopes that it will be soon greatly extended. There may be various ways of inducing such a result. The British Empire was not afraid of China declaring war. On the contrary, many British grew impatient with China, frustrated by the lack of opportunity or desire for China to wage war first. A war with China seems to be a question of the most remote possibility. The government insists that the laws shall be observed by foreigners while resident on the Chinese territory. It is not then easy to conceive how China can ever give such offense to England as to justify a declaration of war. It will never be by any act of aggression on the territories of Great Britain or her allies, by aiding and forming alliances with her enemies, or by the breach of any treaty, for none exist. And as to the balance of power, there can be no cause to fear to any nation of Europe from the power and politics of China. There was no sign China would declare war, nor of committing any offense to justify declaring war on China. War could make those Chinese submit to free trade, but they just won't declare it or do anything worthy of a justifiable declaration of war. So how could the Chinese be forced to comply with European demands without them declaring war on Britain? A fleet of British men of war, a detachment of frigates and brigs up the Yangtze River, would cut off the communication of their canal and stop the interchange of supplies between the northern and southern provinces. And perhaps it would be a work of no very great difficulty to separate the two provinces, Fujian and Guangzhou, from the empire. Understanding China wasn't important in the least, just subjugating it. China had never been ruled by Western powers. It existed mostly with its own kind of dignity in a peculiar and special way. It had its share of violent encounters over the thousands of years it existed, but it had never been a Western submissive country. China made it this far, for the most part, with pride and without humiliation. But that was all over. Surely the British wouldn't continue to fire on the legal trade conducted between their own subjects and the Qing Empire. They had been caught trying to steal the secret to tea manufacturing. They had been involved in several skirmishes with the Chinese, but their power was growing, and with it a vacuum was created, for power cannot grow without the powerless. Another country would soon become powerless, so the British Empire could consume that power for itself. After over 100 years of somewhat peaceful interactions with China, the British warships confronting the legal trade suddenly forgot what Chinese maritime flags looked like. Mistaking the red flag of Qing ships as a banner of war, the British ships turned their guns away from their own countrymen and onto the Chinese escorts. They opened fire, and China would never be the same again. Thanks, everybody. 谢谢.